And now everything is done with the chips. But back then, you had to design your own stuff before the chips were available. And that's what I was used to doing. So I picked up the specs of the Ethernet protocols. And I said, I can design this stuff using off-the-shelf chips now. And I left my job with a couple of friends, and three of us bought some chips from one of the hobby stores in the valley. And we built three boards, and I was able to design its stuff within 3-4 weeks, built, and we had the networking between three different computers working very quickly. So I knew I had 3 to 4 years jump on the market before the chips were going to be available from Intel and Digital, and others to do it. And that's how our company was launched, Echelon. And we went on to ship more than 1 million of those boards. And we also adopted the TCP/IP, which was a Department of Defense protocols that nobody thought would work in the commercial world. But I assumed it should work fine. And I adopted that for the commercial world. And I had TCP/IP and Ethernet solution available for all the available computers within a year. And we sold about 1 million of those before the other people were able to do it. And company did very, very well. Went public in 1987. And so here's the story. So after we leave our job, we want to do it. We have done this three boards. We can demonstrate network works. Now we need the money. So you don't talk to the venture capitalist. And the venture capitalist looked at, says, "Smart engineers, we know Indians are smart engineers. We know their stuff works. And what you're doing is pretty interesting." But entrepreneurship is not about designing the technology. That's one component. Can you guys sell? Can you guys market? Can you guys provide the general management? And then he said, "It's hard for me to imagine that senior marketing and sales guys would work for you. Why don't you guys go find a businessman as your partner?" And what's very clear implication, why don't you get a white guy to be your front? Because most of the marketing and sales guys were white guys, and they will have tough time working for an Indian. And he said, "No, sir, we want to do it ourselves." And he says, "You guys have been pretty obstinate. But maybe it's time to try one. Maybe it's time to fund one of the Indian entrepreneurs and see if they can do it." And he used that kind of logic to give us the funding. And we had no trouble getting people to work for us. In the valley, everybody's very focused on that's new thing. Very few people worry about who's behind it. Nowadays, Indians are everywhere. And so we were the first guys. We brought the glass ceiling. The IPO, I was one of the first Indian CEOs on the NASDAQ, the first one for Silicon Valley for sure. There was one from Southern California a few months earlier. And rest is history. The branding of the Indians changed dramatically after the Indians started to emerge as entrepreneurs in the valley in the 80s. I was one of the pioneers, but there were about maybe 20 of them emerged in the 80s. And some of these guys had done just as telling that stuff as we had done here. We were the pioneers in networking. Suhas Patel, who founded Cirrus Logic, was the first one to do the fabless chip company. He was the guy who figured out the IP design of a chip doesn't have to tie to a fab that you own. So you could outsource the fab to somebody else. And so this whole fabless chip company, now every chip company is almost fabless, except maybe for Intel. And then Prabhu Royal, came up with the Verilog, which totally altered the way people design hardware. Hardware used to be done with a paper and pencil on a drafting board, and now it would be done on a terminal using software. That was done by Prabhu. So there were Indians who had done. By the way, these are all IITians. Prabhu was from IIT Kanpur. Suhas was from IIT Kharagpur. So you looked around, and there was a large number of IITians doing all sorts of latest cutting edge stuff as entrepreneurs. And by the time 90s rolled in, we had arrived. We had arrived in big time. And so I tell people, entrepreneurial journey, is a journey into unknown. You need to be destabilized as an individual. Something needs to destabilize you. We all get very comfortable. We all stay in our comfort zone. We all like the daily routine. Entrepreneurial journey is total antithesis of all that. You get out of your comfort zone. You don't have a daily routine. And it's a journey into the unknown. So you can do it yourself. It's very hard, but some external force has to do it, force to you. Some David Jackson has to destabilize you. Alternately, you get laid off. You're in your 30s, and all of a sudden your company lays you off and throws you out, throws you out of your comfort zone. And many people have found different ways to get there. 1 to 2% of the population is entrepreneurial at large. That's it. This is population at large. And it's about 2% in the US, which is just about the best in the world. And almost everybody in the world is in that range. Japan is probably less than 1%. Japan is one of the oddball societies. I think India is like US. Very poor arts. So no parent will encourage you to become an entrepreneur. 2% arts. The emphasis from the parents has always been in India. Settle down, become responsible. You're not a child anymore. No mother says, beta entrepreneur bano. Right? Get a job at Google, get a job at Facebook, IBM, Microsoft, MNC, right? There's a huge pressure. And there's also a huge opportunity cost. Your IIT education can now get you. I hear numbers which are unbelievable. 50 lakh rupees salary, is that unheard of? Right? That's not unheard of. So it's a huge salary, huge temptation. Why would I go without salary for 3, 4, 5 years when I can get 50 lakhs and have my parents happy? Right? So there's no encouragement from outside. None whatsoever. As a matter of fact, there is a huge discouragement. The odds are against you. 98% odds that you will not make as an entrepreneur. Your friends will not encourage you. Your friends will say, hey, let's go see a movie. And you are working on Saturday and Sunday. You're no fun anymore. They will abandon you. And very few spouses will encourage you because they suffer with you when you made a choice to become an entrepreneur and give up a salary, give up a stable lifestyle. So you have to have this fire from inside. You need this burning desire to show, to prove that you are as good or better than everybody else out there. Making money is never enough of incentive, because you make lot less money for a lot longer before you make money, and that's not a sure thing either. Given the odds, right? So So if that's what drives you, it's not going to be sustainable. So you have to have this thing from inside, this desire to prove yourself. And but here's the other part of the whole thing. If you were able to leave your job and sustain yourself for maybe 6 months to a year at starvation salary, and still keep your dream alive, your odds improve tenfold overnight. Because now you're part of the select few, the 10% that who take that first step. 90% people don't even try. Now you're part of that 10%, who have opted in. 1 to 2%, 2% odds, or 100%, gives you 20% out of this pool, because now you are pool, where your chances have improved very rapidly, right? 20% odds are not that bad, given the upside is unlimited and downside is very limited. If you don't succeed, you don't get a job. You're bad at the job, maybe invested 6 months a year or two, but odds, the bat is very much in your favor. You know, if somebody was to give you 20 times the money for the bet, where the odds are winning 1 in 2, would you place that bet? Every time, right? And that's what this whole thing is all about. And so maybe I should leave at that one, and we can have an interaction, and we can talk about, you know, what's on your mind. Do you have any portable microphone?
Thank you, thank you. Now, sir, I'm a MS graduate from in the aerospace engineering department. My question to you is, I wish to start up a technology enterprise. I want to develop a research in which develops technology. An industry that develops technology for others.
Now you mean outsource R&D?
Yeah.
Okay.
If I'm actually trying to develop such kind of technology, how long will it take for me to get my returns? How long?
It depends on how much returns are enough for you. Right? Yeah, you can become cash flow positive at a small level very quickly. But then you're selling your time and services by and large. You know, you don't get a contract, hey, I'll do the development for you, people will pay you. You know, to make big money is different for you, but your returns on the investment, you know, is a very small investment in that case for you. You know, because you are very quickly being hired as a contract, outsourced, you know, R&D guy. There are many of those companies in India. You know, there's a large one in Pune, what was the name? Persistence, right? Persistence, you know, which has become large and public company. But that will take years, you know, but that entrepreneur wanted to be a large company. But to become profitable, outsource of IT, your services or the development services, you know, doesn't take much money and doesn't, you know, take long to start producing returns. How big, how large is enough for you? Yeah, that's, you get to decide. You know, if you want to, you know, make a bigger deal, then you have to go through this process of, you know, building and sustaining, right? But why would you want to do that one? To me, that sounds like a, you know, me too, and a day late, you know, another 100 companies are already doing it. What's your differentiation? What's your special satisfaction of that, doing that one?
There is a particular technology which
Which technology? Do you have any specific technology in mind?
Yeah. It's related to aerospace engineering. I'm interested to develop a pulse detonation combustion system. So,
which combustion system was first?
Pulse detonation combustion.
Okay.
So it has been of interest for the past 8 years, and lot of big shots are actually working on it. But in India, I'm trying to find at least I'm trying to start it up on my own. I'm trying to work on such industry. But most of the aerospace industries in India are government operated, and they are not working on those projects.
Okay, I mean, I don't know enough to give you any specific advice. Yeah.
And one more question. Is it advisable to start up a company as a fresher without any industrial experience?
So it's like everything else in life, right? Yeah. Would you go and run a race without preparing yourself, getting conditioned, getting shape, practicing? Yeah. So becoming an entrepreneur is not an event. It's a process. You know, so if you're an engineer, you only know one aspect of entrepreneurship technology. You have to learn to sell, you have to learn to market, you have to learn to understand the customers, you have to learn to interact with customers, you have to understand the economics. So there is this breadth of experience that you need to build. So I tell people, if you want to become an entrepreneur, you know, get into a company, you know, for 3 to 4 to 5 years and move around.